Good morning, everybody. Hope everybody can hear me. We're going to read chapter 13. We're going to do part two of chapter 13. And again, thanks to Scholastic for letting us do this. I'm just going to continue on right where I left off yesterday. And the questions will be posted on the assignment on Google Classroom later today. Let's share video. Here we go. So at the end of the last part of this chapter that we'd read, Bruno had met up with Schmel and was talking to him about Lieutenant Kotler behind in the hiding spot just by the fence. Later that evening, Bruno was disappointed to find that Lieutenant Kotler was joining him, mother, father, and Gretel for dinner. Pavel was wearing his white jacket as usual and served them as they ate. Bruno watched Pavel as he went around the table and found that he felt sad whenever he looked at him. He wondered whether the white jacket he wore as a waiter was the same as the white jacket he would have worn before as a doctor, as he brought the plates in and set them down in front of each of them. And while they ate their food and talked, he stepped back towards the wall and held himself perfectly still, neither looking ahead nor not. It was as if his body had gone to sleep, standing up with his eyes open. Whenever anyone needed anything, Pavel would bring it immediately. But the more Bruno watched him, the more he was sure that a catastrophe was going to strike. He seemed to grow smaller and smaller each week, if such a thing were possible, and the color that should have been in his cheeks and drained almost entirely away. His eyes appeared heavy with tears, and Bruno thought that one good blink might bring on a torrent. When Pavel came in with the plates, Bruno couldn't help but notice that his hands were shaking slightly under the weight of them. And when he stepped back to his usual position, he seemed to sway on his foot and had to press a hand against the wall to steady himself. Mother had to ask twice for her extra helping of soup before he heard her, and he let the bottle of wine empty without having opened another. He let the bottle of wine empty without having opened another one in time to fill Father's glass. Her list won't let us read poetry or plays, complained Bruno during the main course. As they had company for dinner, the family were dressed formally, father in his uniform, mother in a green dress that set off her eyes, and Gretel and Bruno in the clothes they wore to church when they lived in Berlin. I asked him if we could read them just one day a week, but he said no, not while he was in charge of our education. I'm sure he has his reasons, said Father, attacking a leg of lamb. All he wants us to do is study history and geography, said Bruno, and I'm starting to hate history and geography. Don't say hate, Bruno, please, Mother, said Mother. Why do you hate history? Asked Father, laying down his fork for a moment, looking across the table at his son, who shrugged his shoulders, a bad habit of his. Because it's boring, he said. Boring, said Father. A son of mine calling the study of history boring. Let me tell you this, Bruno, he went on, leaning forward and pointing his knife at the boy. It's history that's got us here today. If it wasn't for history, none of us would be sitting around this table now. We'd be safely back at our table in our house in Berlin. We are correcting history here. It's still boring, repeated Bruno, who wasn't really paying attention. You'll have to forgive my brother, Lieutenant Kotler, said Gretel, laying a hand on his arm for a moment, which made Mother stare at her and narrow her eyes. He's a very ignorant little boy. I am not ignorant, snapped Bruno, who had had enough of her insults. You have to forgive my sister, Lieutenant Kotler, he added politely, but she's a hopeless case. There's very little we can do for her. The doctors say she's gone past the point of help. Shut up, said Gretel, blushing scarlet. You shut up, said Bruno with a broad smile. Children, please, said Mother. Father tapped his knife on the table and everyone was silent. Bruno glanced in his direction. He didn't look angry exactly, but he did look as if he wasn't going to put up with much more arguing. I enjoyed history very much when I was a boy, said Lieutenant Kotler after a few silent moments. And although my father was a professor of literature at the university, I preferred the social sciences to arts. I didn't know that, Kurt, said Mother, turning to look at him for a moment. Does he still teach then? I suppose so, said Lieutenant Kotler. I don't really know. Well, how could you not know, she asked, frowning at him. Don't you keep in touch with him? The young lieutenant chewed on a mouthful of lamb and gave him an opportunity to think of a reply. He looked to Bruno as if he regretted having brought the matter up in the first place. Kurt, repeated Mother, don't you keep in touch with your father? Not really, he replied, shrugging his shoulders dismissively and not turning his head to look at her. He left Germany some years ago. 1938, I think it happened. I haven't seen him since. Father stopped eating for a moment and stared across at Lieutenant Kotler, frowning slightly. And where did he go? He asked. I beg your pardon, Herr Commandant? Asked Lieutenant Kotler, even though Father had spoken in a perfectly clear voice. I asked you where he went, he repeated. Your father, the professor of literature, where did he go when he left Germany? Lieutenant Kotler's face grew a little red, and he stuttered somewhat as he spoke. I believe he is currently in Switzerland, he said finally. The last I heard, he was teaching at a university in Bern. Oh, but Switzerland's a beautiful country, said Mother quickly. I haven't ever been there, but from what I hear, he can't be very old, your father, said Father, his deep voice silencing them all. I mean, you're only, what, 17, 18 years old? I just turned 19, Herr Commandant. So your father would be in his 40s, I expect. Lieutenant Kotler said nothing but continued to eat, although he didn't appear to be enjoying his food at all. Strange that he chose not to stay in the fatherland, said Father. We're not close, my father and I, said Lieutenant Kotler, quickly looking around the table, as if he owed everyone an explanation. Really, we haven't spoken in years. What reason did he give, might I ask, continued Father, for leaving Germany at the moment of her greatest glory and her most vital need, when it is incumbent upon all of us to play our part in the national revival? Was he tubercular? Lieutenant Kotler stared at Father, confused. I beg your pardon, he asked. Did he go to Switzerland to take air, explained Father? Or did he have a particular reason for leaving Germany? In 1938, he added after a moment. I'm afraid I don't know, Herr Commandant, said Lieutenant Kotler. You would have to ask him. Well, that would be rather difficult to do, wouldn't it, with him being so far away? I mean, but perhaps that was it. Perhaps he was ill. Father hesitated before picking up his knife and fork again and continuing to eat. Or perhaps he had disagreements. Disagreements, Herr Commandant? With government policy. One hears tales of men like this from time to time. Curious fellows, I imagine. Disturbed, some of them. Traitors, others. Cowards, too. Of course, you have informed your superiors of your father's views, Lieutenant Kotler. The young lieutenant opened his mouth and then swallowed, despite the fact that he hadn't been eating anything. Never mind, said Father cheerfully. Perhaps it is not an appropriate conversation for the dinner table. We can discuss it more in depth at a later date. Herr Commandant, said Lieutenant Kotler, leaning forward anxiously, I can assure you, it is not appropriate conversation for the dinner table, repeated Father sharply, silencing him immediately. And Bruno looked from one to the other, both enjoying and being frightened at the atmosphere at the same time. I'd love to go to Switzerland, said Gretel after a lengthy silence. Eat your dinner, Gretel, said Mother. But I was just saying, eat your dinner, Mother repeated, and was about to say more when she was interrupted by Father calling for Pavel again. What's the matter with you tonight? He asked as Pavel uncorked the new bottle. This is the fourth time I've had to ask for more wine. Bruno watched him, hoping he was feeling all right, although he managed to release the cork without any accidents. But after he had filled Father's glass and turned to refill Lieutenant Kotler's, he lost his grip of the bottle somehow, and it fell crashing, glug, glug, glugging, its content out directly onto the young man's lap. What happened then was both unexpected and extremely unpleasant. Lieutenant Kotler grew very angry with Pavel and no one, not Bruno, not Gretel, not Mother, not even Father, stepped in to stop him doing what he did next. Even though none of them could watch, even though it made Bruno cry and Gretel grow pale. Later that night, when Bruno went to bed, he thought about all that had happened over dinner. He remembered how kind Pavel had been to him on the afternoon he had made the swing, and how he had stopped his knee from bleeding, being very gentle in the way he administered the green ointment. And while Bruno realized that Father was generally a very kind and thoughtful man, it hardly seemed fair or right that no one stopped Lieutenant Kotler getting so angry at Pavel. If that was the kind of thing that went on and out with, then he'd better not disagree with anyone anymore about anything. In fact, he would do well to keep his mouth shut and cause no chaos at all. Some people might not like it. His old life in Berlin seemed like a very distant memory now, and he could hardly even remember what Carl, Daniel, and Martin looked like, except for the fact that one of them was a ginger. That's the end of chapter 13. We'll be reading chapter 14 on Monday. Have a great weekend, everybody. See you in the Zoom meeting later today.